So I'm joined here today for the vote by Oli Ryan from PlanBee. Welcome back to the latest. So it's exam time, isn't it, for a lot of youngsters? We had a GCSE results, the A-level results. So what are you offering to children, parents and teachers in terms of your output? And why is it such a stressful time for youngsters now at this moment in time?
Well, at PlanBee, our focus is on primary education. So a lot of the resources and information advice we provide is for primary teachers, so that's ages 5 to 11. But we've also been thinking about what parents and children are going through as they start the new school year. So this period of transition, quite a lot of change, new pressures, a difficult time for some children, parents and for teachers as well. So we've been focusing on how we can provide some advice, some information and a little bit of support, particularly to teachers. But we've also written some advice on our website for parents as well.
Yeah, and also I should say, what does PlanBee actually, what do you actually do? Because we featured you before, but just for viewers that didn't see that programme, what are the services that PlanBee offers?
PlanBee's a small team of former primary teachers, and what we do is we write and create teaching resources for use in the classroom. So they're time-saving and they're completely ready to teach. Teachers can buy them, download them and use them straight away in the class.
Yeah. And so you offer, is it kind of written guidance that you're offering at this moment in time, or do you offer kind of practical advice down the phone or
well, so in person? Well, so all year round we provide lesson planning and teaching resources for use in the classroom, and that's available all year round. But particularly at this time of year, the new school year, back to school, we focus as well on our website on providing some advice for teachers. Perhaps if they're moving to teach a new school year group. Yeah. We've got specific advice at planbee.com for them. But we've also got some advice for parents as well to support their children during that period of transition, starting in primary school or moving up through the year groups in primary, or perhaps as well finishing primary and moving on to secondary school.
Yeah. And what advice would you give to children that might not have done as well as they thought they had done, for example, in GCSEs, but also A-level? Maybe start with GCSE, because it's not the end of the world, is it? They didn't quite get the grades that they thought they were going to get. It might seem that at the time, but
no,
it doesn't turn out to be that way most of the time, does
absolutely.
It?
Absolutely. I didn't get the grades I wanted, and I remember very well how that felt at the time. But I would say that this time of year is a really good time, actually, for pupils, young people of that age, to reflect and just have a think about where their interests lie, where their talents lie, what they're good at. Take stock and don't worry too much about those exam results.
Yeah. And so what kind of feelings do you think youngsters are going to be going through at the moment, you know, as they kind of navigate, you know, the post-exam result time?
Well, for many of them who are returning to school now, to carry on with their education. I remember what it was like. You've had your summer holidays and there's that apprehension, isn't there? Those nerves about returning. So I can remember very well what that was like, and I'm sure all teachers and all parents as well can remember what it was like. The advice that we offer to teachers on our website, but also for parents as well, is just to try and take a broad overview of what's going on with your own children or the children you're teaching, to listen and notice.
Yeah.
So be there for them and just notice any changes in behaviour, signs that those children might be struggling with that transition, whether it's just from one year group to another or one school to another. It's an important time for us as adults to be aware of those changes and be ready to step in and guide and lead. That's our job as parents, as teachers, as adults, is to guide and lead children at that time. They need that support and advice during transition in the new school year.
Yes, and is that for teachers both at GCSE and A-level? So what kind of age ranges are we looking at here?
Well, I think broadly speaking, the advice is true for all teachers of all ages. Of course, we focus on primary age, but the same is true for teachers of older age groups as well. A lot of teachers will move around and be teaching a new year group for the first time perhaps this year, an age range that they've not worked with before. And while each age range of children carries its own challenges, broadly speaking, the approach is the same, which is to, as I said, listen and notice, but also to reassure as well and support, and then to guide and lead. I think those are the three sort of guiding principles which will help teachers of any age children in the new school year.
Yeah, and so is this, do teachers generally get training on how to kind of deal with children, you know, that have just had the results? What kind of training do they get? And do you think it, where can it be improved?
There's no guidance or training at all in my experience for that kind of thing, supporting children through those things and after their exam results. I think that's something you learn on the job. And of course, you know, as parents, that's the sort of thing that you just learn as you go as well. And, you know, you can seek advice from other more experienced teachers. Other parents can seek advice from parents and friends, that kind of thing. But no, sadly, there's nothing in place really that I'm aware of that prepares teachers and parents for supporting children through this time. It's just about some common sense as well, of course. But you can always seek advice from other colleagues, that kind of thing.
Yeah. And where's... Things have changed, haven't they, in recent times? So that people, kids are under a lot more stress. There's social media. You know, when you see people getting exam results in the media, it's often that they've got A's or A stars, and most people don't get those grades. So it's a lot more stressful time, isn't it? Because you're kind of more aware of what other people have got, including your friends, you know?
Absolutely, absolutely, yeah. Children who and young people who've received their GCSE and A-level results, of course, they're much more inclined at that age to compare their own achievements and accomplishments to those of their peers, and that's very difficult, absolutely very difficult. Again, with our focus on slightly younger children and teachers of those younger children, even at ages seven and up, I would say children become fairly aware of the accomplishments, the achievements, the sort of levels at which the children, the other children in their class are working at. And of course they compare themselves to that. So that's a pressure that exists for all children. But again, our job as teachers, myself, I'm a former teacher, but as parents as well, I think is to find a way to reassure children that that's okay. We're all at different stages in that learning process.
Yeah, and GCSEs, they've changed, because I only found out recently that, well, not just so much GCSEs, but A-levels, the whole curriculum's changed, hasn't it? It's quite difficult to know what kind of qualifications are still valid, or, for example, the AS levels. I didn't realise till recently that they've been discontinued. So have GCSEs changed, or are they still the same kind of GCSEs that I took when I was younger? Is there a big emphasis on coursework now, or, I mean, where are we?
It's difficult, isn't it, for us older ones now to...
As an employer, firstly, it must be quite tricky as well, I think.
Yeah, it's difficult for me, distant memory, just to think back to what it was like. But it's even more difficult, I think, for us to understand and compare where we stood ourselves with our learning at that point to where children are now. Things have changed drastically. The grading systems have changed. So when we were getting, I don't know about you, but when I was getting B's, C's and D's in my GCSEs, those particular grades aren't really comparable to the same ones that children are getting now, in my view. The learning's changed, moved on. So
yes, there's bigger emphasis on coursework, which always suited me rather than exams. I wasn't the best at exams, but I was really good at doing coursework. So is that the kind of direction that it's gone in now, in terms of you know, what is required by in qualifications?
Well, I can't speak so much for secondary education, but certainly in primary education in the last few years, we've been part of that broadening of the curriculum and approaches to learning that does happen further up in schools and in in that higher education. So we, as primary teachers, we take into account the fact that children learn in different ways. Some children are better suited to different types of learning, like coursework, as you say, with older children. So we try to take that into account in primary education. And of course, all good primary teachers do as well. In our resources which we provide for primary teachers, we try to take that into account as well. We provide a variety of learning and activities to ensure that there's something that all children can get their teeth into and really get to grips with and achieve at.
Yeah, okay, second half we're going to be focusing a lot more on A-levels and you know, particularly university as well, because it's kind of, the mindset is changing at university is not the only option to people that have just done their A-levels, but we'll focus on that in the second half. So join us for the second half. We'll be speaking to Oli a bit more about PlanBee and also about what students can do for A-level students in particular, you know, once now they've got their grades. Okay, so join us for the second half. So welcome back to The Vote. I'm here with Oli Ryan from PlanBee. So spoke a lot about GCSEs in the first half and about youngsters that are getting their GCSE results. A-level results just come out as well. There seems to be a change of mindset in terms of universities seem to be the only option for a lot of kids. You know, everyone wanted to go to uni. We've now got nearly 50% participation rate for youngsters who are going to university. But is that necessarily the right approach? Because there's more apprenticeships, there's other avenues available, isn't there? And university is not for everyone, is it?
Oh, no, absolutely not. I didn't think it was for me. I didn't get the A-levels I wanted. And so I didn't go to university immediately after finishing. I went later and it was a worthwhile experience for me. But it's not for everybody, is it? Absolutely. And as you say, there are many routes into further education and further training. I mean, I can speak particularly about routes into teaching, because as a former teacher, that's sort of my area of interest. I actually returned to education well long after I finished at university and I'd been working for a long time. I returned to education to do my teacher training via a PGCE, which is like a fast track
route. Postgraduate certificate in education, right?
That's right, yeah. And it's a real fast track into teaching, which actually you don't necessarily need to have a degree to do.
Yeah.
If you've got the A-level results in English, maths, GCSE results, that kind of thing, that's a route into teaching that many people take, and certainly the one that I took, that doesn't require 3 years of study prior to doing it, you know.
Yeah, you can't tell the difference, to be honest. I would have thought you were going straight to university, so it just proves my point. But there's apprenticeships as well, isn't there? So, because some people don't flourish until later on in their life, do they? Some people don't kind of want to get into or become an academic in a way and have that kind of skill set until later on in their life. So there's a lot more mature students now, isn't there, than there were in the past. Open University is a great example of that. So there just needs to be greater understanding of that, particularly for younger people that think, you know, this is their time to go to university. That can happen later on in their career, can't it? Particularly when you retrain.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. It must be such a difficult time, I imagine, for students who didn't get the grades that they wanted or hoped to get. But I think, as we spoke about before, this is a good time to reflect, actually, and think about your own strengths and your achievements.
Yes.
And there are many opportunities, not just in this September immediately after receiving your exam results, for further training, further education, and further sort of personal or professional development. It doesn't have to happen now, it can happen later in life. You can take a break from work and return to education later on, as I did. And you know, like many of us, I think I fall into that category that you described there, where I didn't feel like I was particularly suited to academia at that point in my life,
yeah,
either. But that may well change, as it did for me, and it may well change for a lot of young people who didn't get the results that they want or get the places at university they wanted. There's plenty of opportunities down the line.
And you've changed career, haven't you? Because you were a primary school teacher, now you're in a second career almost, aren't you? So people are going to have two or three careers, aren't they, in nowadays? They're not going to stay, by and large, with the same employer or doing the same thing throughout their life, particularly if they're working till, you know, into the 70s. They are going to have multiple careers, aren't they? So
absolutely, yeah. Yeah, there'll be numerous changes throughout your life and your career, aren't there? I really thought that teaching was it for me, and that was going to be it.
Yeah.
My thoughts changed a little bit, and, you know, to be honest, I maybe didn't have the same strength and fortitude of a lot of teachers still out there doing it, you know, to cope with that hard grind. And now I have a wonderful opportunity to do something else, which is to write advice, lesson planning, and make resources for those teachers still in it and help them.
Yeah. So you being a former teacher, this summer period, what do teachers normally do, primary school teachers, what would they be doing? Because a lot of people think, you know, kind of they're on the beach and have an extended holiday, which I know isn't true. So what are they, well, for those of us that don't know, you know, what do teachers, how do you kind of prepare for a new term, school term?
Well, firstly, I would say I really do hope, actually, that teachers have for at least some of these summer holidays sat on the beach, read a book, had a glass of wine, taken the time to rest and relax. And of course, there is some time to do that. But when people talk about, oh, yeah, 6 weeks off, it's really not like that for teachers. Most teachers you will find are continuing to work in school long after the children have left at the end of the summer term, and most teachers will have been back in school for some time already, even though here we are shortly before the start of the new school year, preparing the classrooms, preparing planning. They'll be working with other teachers to learn about the children who they'll be receiving for the new school year. They'll be developing the curriculum for the new school year. So that's finding that lesson planning, writing that lesson planning. Maybe it's from us, or maybe they're producing it themselves.
Yeah.
Classroom displays, that kind of thing.
Yeah. There's going to be, whoever, if there's a new election, general election, there's going to be more funding for schools. So where do you think that should be prioritised going forward? Because it looks like we're going to get some big announcements by all the political parties on education funding, perhaps up to $4 billion a year throughout the education system. Where, being a former teacher, where would you say that, what are the priorities, do you think?
I speak very often to teachers, head teachers, senior leadership at primary schools, and what they have been telling us for the last few years is the same sort of story from one primary school to another, which is that in real terms, reductions in funding have meant that they are insufficiently staffed to provide the tailored learning and support that children with a range of abilities and a range of requirements need. So a bit like what we were talking about some children learn better in different ways and are better suited to different learning tasks, like the coursework thing you were talking about. In the past, when there was more money available, schools and teachers could put the resources and the staff in place to support children learn better in a variety of ways. And the cutbacks have meant that it's more difficult to create that broad supportive curriculum with enough staff to help the children who need it most. So they're crying out for more money for staffing and resources.
Yeah, and reducing class sizes, is that the way forward? Maybe, but the average class size, what, is about 30 children in primary school? So maybe more
30,
funding to
more.
Kind of get that down to maybe 25? Is that?
I mean, that would be absolutely wonderful. I think that may not be something that happens anytime soon.
Yeah.
But certainly class sizes couldn't really grow any more than what they're currently at. I think schools are at capacity, school classrooms and the resourcing is at capacity in terms of that. And of course, smaller class sizes would be a wonderful thing to provide more support to individual children. But schools are well equipped and experienced at dealing with the class sizes they have. So I really think that additional funding for even things like resources like glue, pencils, books, computer software, computers, as well as staffing is really where the money is needed most.
Yeah. Just before we finish up, so what's next for Plan B? You've got new school terms coming up, so what are the priorities for Plan B at the moment?
To support primary teachers as they go through the new school year. We're really proud to have just finished a complete maths curriculum for primary schools and teachers. So that means that a teacher or a school can get all of their maths planning for the entire school year from us should they need it. Mm. We have a range of other resources for other subjects available, but our focus is on supporting teachers, finding the right resources, getting the stuff out that will save them a little bit of time and give their children great learning experiences. Yeah.
Where can people find out more information about Plan B, your website, and where do people need to go to?
PlanBee.com.
Yeah.
Is our website, and as well as all of the teaching resources available, we also have an extensive blog full of articles and advice for teachers, including advice for the new school year transition and supporting children in your new class.
Yeah, just finally before we go, have you got any ideas about, what would you like if you had a, if you could input into a manifesto, what would it be? What the manifesto on education, what would that consist of? What would be your top three priorities, for example?
More funding for staffing, more funding for resources, and more funding for support of children with special needs.
Great. Special needs in particular. There is a greater need, isn't there, on greater focus on kids with complex needs nowadays, isn't there? So that's an area where we've improved on in recent years.
There have been certain significant steps forward in greater provision for children with special educational needs in years past, yeah. But actually there's some difficulty now with funding and children who need that extra support and not getting the processes of their care plans put in place, which are the things that then provide that support that they need. It's not happening fast enough.
We'll leave it there. Great. Thanks, Oli, for coming in today. All the best with Plan B, and we'll catch up again soon.
Thanks.